for seeing kissing. My heart turns violently inside of my chest. I don't have time to maintain these regrets when I think about the way.
Matthew 16, verses 24 through 26. It says this: Then said Jesus unto his disciples, If any man will come after me, let him deny himself, and take up his cross, and follow me. For whosoever shall save his life shall lose it, and whosoever shall lose his life for my sake shall find it. For what is a man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Heavenly Father, Lord, here tonight. Lord, I pray that you would just let heaven come down and touch earth for just a little while. God, as we are gathered here in your name, Lord, we have come to worship you tonight. Lord, help us to push out everything else that is on our minds. All the burdens that we carry, all the troubles, all the worries. And Lord, let us just worship you this evening. And Heavenly Father, I pray through your word and the anointing of the Holy Spirit that you would speak to us tonight, God, to our hearts, and let us respond to your word. God, that we can proclaim ourselves dead to the world, but alive in you. Amen. Heavenly Father, help us to accomplish this evening. And Lord, we give you all the glory and honor, and it is in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. Amen. The word of God says here that if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up the cross and follow me. Amen. That means that you have to say no sometimes. Amen. My little girl is just now getting the word no. She just now understands what that is, and it's very dramatic. Amen. When she says no, she says no. And I'm like, honey, it's not that big of a deal. She told us at Cracker Barrel the other day, she said, all done? She hit A, but we haven't even started eating yet. And I said, no, honey, we're not done. You know, we need to eat. She said, no! Very dramatic. Amen? But even at one, you learn the use of the word no. Amen? Sometimes it's hard to tell yourself no. Amen? Like that extra trip to the buffet. Amen? Sometimes it's hard to say no. Oh, I didn't get an amen on that. Let me go. I must be stepping on a toe or two. Amen. I got me. Amen. You have to learn self-denial. And that's what Jesus is saying. If you want to follow Jesus, you can't say yes to everything. Amen. You have to be able to say no sometimes. Amen. So he's saying, if you're going to follow me, then you can't say yes to the world all the time. You can't say yes to everything. You say yes to me and no to them. Amen. If God's word proclaims that it is a yes, then it's a yes. And if his word proclaims that it is a no, then it is a no. Amen? You have to learn through the Holy Spirit sometimes to discern what is yes and what is no. But if you're going to follow Jesus, there's going to come some times that you have to say no. Amen? You have to deny yourself. I want it, but I can't do it. It seems like a good idea, but I just can't give in to it. Amen? Sometimes you've just got to say no. And he goes on to say, for whosoever shall save his life shall lose it, and whosoever shall lose his life for my sake shall find it. It's the opposite of what you think. If you try to save yourself and you spend your whole time worried about you, then you lose you. Amen, in the end. But if you will surrender yourself to him, then you gain your life. Amen. It's the exact opposite of the way the world works. Because the world says, take care of you, and then worry about the rest of it. But Jesus says, surrender yourself unto me, and I'll give you the world. Amen. Amen? You have to be able to submit yourself and give yourself up and surrender to him. Because if you try to grasp on, you're going to lose. Amen? And then finally in verse 26 it says, for what is a man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? What is worth your soul? What is worth an eternity in hell? Is there anything on this earth that be given to you that is worth giving up your eternity? No, there is not. Amen. I am not a mathematician. Amen. I don't do good with equations when they have X's and things like that in them. But you know what? I am smart enough to know that there is nothing that is greater than an eternity with Christ. Amen. Nothing. And there is nothing that is worse than an eternity without him. Amen. Amen? Amen? Nothing. And so I do know that. This old country boy knows that tonight. And so the walking dead, you think, what? We're going to talk about death. Absolutely. We're near Halloween, right? You guys wanted a themed thing here, right? We're near. We don't like to think about death. You know, I did a study on this. The church where I'm at had been there for quite some time. There's a cemetery outside of the church. That's unusual these days because we don't usually put the cemeteries near the church. And the reason that is because people do not like to think about death. When you pass by the gravestones, you know it's coming. Amen? Amen. It's coming. But we don't want to think about it. We want to press that out. But I'm here to tell you tonight that it's coming for everybody. Amen. Amen? It's unavoidable. I used to sell life insurance. You know, and we sell it like it might happen. It's going to happen. Amen. You will use it. If you keep it all your life, you will use it one day. Church, we can't avoid it. It's going to happen. Sarah Winchester. You're probably familiar with Winchester firearms and ammunition. Sarah Winchester, her husband had made a fortune by selling rifles and ammunition. In 1918, he died of the flu. She moved to San Jose, California, and she really couldn't deal with the grief. And so she goes and contacts some medium, and they tell her that as long as she builds on to the mansion that they own, and she keeps building on to it, that she will not die. And so she keeps building. And so the mansion eventually had 150 rooms, 13 bathrooms, 2,000 doors, 47 fireplaces, 10,000 windows. And she left enough material at her death that they could have continued building for another 80 years. She still died. Amen? In life, we often concern ourselves with stuff that's going on, occupations, things that happen in our life, day-to-day things. You know, talents, skills, belongings. But it's not more important. Not important anymore when you die. Amen? How much money you had, how much talent, all that stuff that we busy ourselves with from day to day, when you come to the point where you die, it does not matter anymore. Amen? The only thing that matters at that point is, did you know Jesus? Amen? It doesn't matter how much you had, how talented, how educated, what house you lived on, street, address, none of that matters. When you come to that point of death, it doesn't matter how rich you are, she could not avoid it, you will not avoid it. Amen. But the question that is asked at that time is, do you know Jesus? Amen. And that's the only one that's going to matter when you get to that point. Amen. And so that decision, our life, we don't have a whole lot of things that we could choose to do. Life just happens sometimes. Oftentimes things just happen without us being able to control it. And we just have to deal with it. People get sick. There's loss. There's tragedy. There are all kinds of things that happen. You don't have a whole lot of choice, but you do have a choice of whether or not you can follow Jesus or not. Amen. That is a choice that you are faced with. And your decision there will change how you look at death. Amen. How you do that. Because if you know Jesus, then death is just a step over. It is a transition from the material world into the eternal. It is going from sickness and being beat down into a place with no tears and no sickness. It is a place where we will walk on the streets paved with gold. It is a place that there is no sorrow. Amen. It is a transition into the promised land for those of us who have chosen to follow Jesus. Amen. Amen. So death isn't quite what it appears to be. It is just propelling us into the eternal. But for those who do not know Jesus, death seems like a finality. It makes it seem like it's over, but it's not over for them either. Amen. We all will face eternity. The question is where? Amen. 1 Corinthians 15 and 51 says, behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. At the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and then the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and the mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall we be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? Amen. If you're a child of God, then you've got victory over death. Hallelujah. Church, I believe, I know this sounds crazy. You might think this is, maybe I shouldn't say it, but I would rather do a funeral for a saint of God, then I'd rather do that than a wedding. Hate weddings. Amen. It's an honor to do them for people I love, but I don't like doing them. But a funeral for a saint of God is a celebration. Because we can say, death doesn't have sting anymore. Amen. Not for them. Not where they are, not where they're going. Amen. I enjoy a homecoming service where someone has fought a good fight, that they have left a legacy, and they are finally at home. Amen. Amen. Because one day I want to be where they are. Amen. Amen. I want to find myself in that same place. And I want them to be able to shout victory around my casket because death has lost its sting. Hallelujah. Amen. There's no reason to be glum or down, because if you know Jesus, then I'm just going on. Amen. And so I want barbecue and a celebration at mine. Amen. I don't want everybody to be down. It is a celebration. It's a homecoming. I am no longer bound by this world, but I have transcended, and I am with Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Death, where is your sting? Death has no sway or power over a believer. And so let me get into my point. That was a prequel. I had you going for a minute, didn't I? The walking dead. I've just got two statements. That doesn't sound bad, does it? First one is this: alive but dead. Alive but dead. What in the world are you talking about, preacher? Luke 12 and 16 says this: and he spake a parable unto them, saying, the ground of a certain rich man brought forth plentifully. And he thought within himself, saying, what shall I do, because I have no room where to bestow my fruits? And he said, this will I do. I will pull down my barns and build greater. And there I will bestow all my fruits and my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, thou hast much goods laid up for many years. Take thine ease, eat, drink, and be merry. But God said unto him, thou fool, this night thy soul shall be required of thee. Then whose shall those things be which thou hast provided? So he hath laid up treasure for himself and is not rich toward God. The world tells us, every advertisement, everything we do, to focus on yourself, your happiness, your stuff. You need this car. You know, we're coming up near the holiday season, and Lexus has these commercials of the vehicles wrapped up outside. You know, it's a status symbol. They want you to think that you need that to be happy. It's the enemy. The enemy's always out advertising. He does a good job of it. He wants you to buy into it. Amen. He didn't go to the Garden of Eden and shove an apple in anybody's mouth. Amen. People said the devil made me do it. No, he didn't. Amen. Amen. He tricked you into doing it. Amen. He got you to buy in. Amen. Yep. He tricked you to do it. Amen. He tricked Eve and Adam. They went along with it. He is a trickster. He's in deception. And he is into marketing. And he wants us to believe that we've got to have all this stuff that we see and spend our whole life like this guy, chasing after more. I've got to have this, and I've got to have that, and my kids have to have these certain clothes, and you know, we have to live up to the certain standard so other people don't look at us and look down their noses at us. Amen? That's a lie. It's a lie of the enemy. Because see, he works with distraction. If you're a believer, then he doesn't have you, but he surely would distract you. He wants you to focus on stuff, things, material. And the point of that whole parable is, when God calls you home, it don't matter. Amen. He said, who's going to have your stuff now? Amen. Don't spend all of your time worrying about here and now the material things. Amen. It's a lie of the enemy. Don't work yourself to death over nothing just to get more stuff, just to get more indebted, and then you're just more and more a slave to making payments. Amen. And then you've got to miss stuff in your life and in church because you're too busy working. Because you can't, you're up to your eyeballs. And you can't do anything about it. That's the trick of the enemy. He loves that. He signs off on it all the time. But it's not about that. There are people walking around alive, breathing, but they're dead inside. Amen. The whole world out there that doesn't know Jesus, they're alive and breathing as far as I can tell, but they're dead spiritually. Amen. They're over here serving the world and serving material and living in the day today and saying, let's just do what we want to do today and forget about tomorrow and just do what makes us happy. But on the inside, they're missing something. Amen. And they keep trying to fill that hole with something else, with material things. But it does not work. And when they lay their heads down at night, there is still an uneasy unrest inside of their heart. They are alive, but they are not truly alive. They're dead. They don't truly have the joy and happiness that you can only get through serving Jesus Christ. Amen. They don't have the peace of mind that lay their head down at night and not worry about a thing. But they are dead. Alive, but dead. Millions of them. Live in the moment. Focus on a good time. You know, and some, I've seen people so involved in working out that that's all they do. Amen. You know, I ain't against it, but I don't get to it a whole lot, brother. Amen. You know, but that's not a bad thing. But that's not life. You can't spend your whole life working on this. You know, people that won't do anything spiritually, but physically, they spend all their time on that and material stuff and trying to go out on these fancy vacations and do. If you can afford it, great. If you can't, you better not. Amen. Amen. Don't spend your whole time doing that. It's a trick of the enemy. And he gets people to buy into it, especially in the church. We do it too. Amen. John 10:10 says, the thief cometh not, but to steal, kill, and destroy. I'm come that they might have life and that more abundantly. He wants to steal your time. He wants to steal your energy, and he wants to steal you away. Amen. If he can keep your family messed up, then y'all be arguing all the time, and you ain't got time for nothing else. If he can keep you working, he doesn't care what it is. As long as your eyes are taken off Jesus, the devil doesn't care what you're thinking about or dealing with, as long as he can distract you from it. He is a thief, and he wants to steal your life. Amen? He wants it all your time. And if you spend all your time fighting, then you can't do anything. It works that way in church, too. You can't win people for Jesus in a church if you're fighting all the time. If the pastor, I'm not a pastor here, so I'm just going to say this. If the pastor spends all his time having to put out fires, you can't win people for Jesus. And if people walk in here off the street and they find out that there's as much drama going on here as there is out in the world, guess what? They say, why do I need that? I've got enough problems as it is. I don't need to come to church and do that. And meanwhile, the devil has us putting out fires, running one place to another, trying to help people. We're just falling apart. Amen? But we're not winning people for the Lord because we're so inwardly focused. That's what the devil does. He focuses on us. It's all about me, my needs, my emotions. And Jesus says it's not all about you. It's about God. It's about the mission. It's about being the sons and daughters of God and being about God's business. And if we can take the focus off of us and put it on Him, He said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. He said He'll take care of you if you'll focus on Him.
Amen.
If you put Him first. But the enemy says you better take care of yourself because nobody else will do it. It's a lie. Amen? Focus on God first and He will do the rest. Do you trust Him? Amen. Amen. It is a shame that we have people walking around alive but dead. Searching. Ever searching. But Jesus said in John 3:3, verily, verily, I say unto thee that except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. He's saying that even though you are alive and you're a breathing person, he's talking to Nicodemus. But he's saying, although you're alive, you're not. You have to be born again. Born of the Spirit. You see, Nicodemus, he recognized the authenticity of Jesus. He knew that there was something about Him. Nicodemus was a teacher. He is an authority on Scripture. This man knows the Old Testament. He knows the Word of God. And so he knew all that. I'm sure he was a good moral man. But Jesus still told him that you must be born again. Amen? He still told him that. Because that is the truth. You have to be born again. You are not truly, fully alive until you get born again. Amen. It's been a little while for me, but I still remember. I was so excited. That's why I like young people. I work with kids quite a bit. I love that excitement that comes when you first get saved. And, you know, especially young people, they want to tackle the world. I was talking to some people the other day, and they're like, I want to be a missionary, and I want to do, you know, I mean, they were just all over the place. And I'm like, that's good. You know, go do it. You know, tackle it. I don't want to be one of those old guys that said, oh, you can't do that, you can't do it. Let them learn. Let them learn. No, you know what? I thought they may do it. You know, who am I to say no to that? Let them go. Do it. Do it. Because, see, they've only been saved like a year. You know, they still feel that fresh, new, oh, I'm alive. I can't believe it. Here all this time I've been walking around and I just didn't know. Amen. How many of us have been saved a while and need to get back to that? Amen. To realize how good we have it. Amen. To say, oh my goodness, this is awesome.
Amen.
I was once dead, but now I'm alive.
Amen.
Amen. I didn't know what was going on, but God opened up my eyes. And I'm telling you, I'm blessed. I am forgiven. I've got peace in my life. And I've got a home in heaven.
Amen.
My goodness. Shouldn't we be excited? Shouldn't we be ready to serve God?
Yes.
Amen? But it's hard to find anybody to do anything. Oh, it hurts. It is. You know, you say, well, we would pay the pastor. Yeah, sure, but he's only one man. He's supposed to give you direction and you're supposed to do.
Amen.
I'm just being biblical here. He didn't put me up to this. I'm telling you that it's not like that. He can't do it. If he's doing it, he can only do as much as God can put on him. Amen? But if we get behind him and we all do what God would have us to do, my goodness, you wouldn't be able to contain the people in this place. Amen? If we'll focus on God instead of us. And I got this last one. Here's the main point. I said there are people that are alive but dead. But the goal is to be dead but alive. To be dead but alive. Romans 6:3. Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death? Therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, like Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father. Even so, we should also walk in newness of life. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall also in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him and the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. For he that is dead is freed from sin. Now if we be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him, knowing that Christ being raised from the dead died no more. Death has no more dominion over him. For in that he died unto sin, but in that he liveth unto God. Likewise, reckon yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Christ our Lord. Church, we're to be dead to the world, amen, but alive to Christ. Amen. There's separation between us in the world. Amen. We've been bought with a price. Amen. We need not just blend in. You are different. The difference is that Jesus shed his blood so that you could have forgiveness. He paid a price so that you could be different, so that you're set apart. You've been purchased. Amen. That means that you no longer have an obligation to this world. You're not tied to it. You are free from those obligations. Amen. Now here, I've often heard where, you know, we are travelers and we are just passing through, and that is the truth. I've got another one for you. This one just hit me the other day. You are deployed. Okay? You are in God's service and you are deployed in a foreign country. Amen. Now, when we send people to Afghanistan, do they become Afghanis? No, they do not. Our servicemen and women, although they may be in a different country, do not become those people. They do not become Afghani citizens. They are still United States citizens. So they still speak English. They still keep our customs. They still have our benefits, although they're in a different place. Church, now you are deployed. You are on a battlefield. You have been sent to do a mission. Don't lose sight, because the devil will tell you you've been here a long time and you're a part of it. But I'm here to tell you, you're only deployed, and he will call you back one day, and you will get to go home to heaven where your citizenship lies. Amen. Amen. Citizen of heaven with all the rights thereof. Amen. I send word back to my embassy whenever I need help. I am just here. I am not a part of it. I'm not becoming part of the culture. I am separate. I have been bought with a price. I am not a citizen here. I am just a citizen there. Hallelujah. So I want to tell you this. The devil comes at you and starts talking to people. Tell me this. You know, I counsel folks and whatnot, right? This guy, he has to do that too. People come and tell me, well, the devil's been doing this and been doing. Why are you listening to him? Stop. So let me tell you what to tell him. That guy's dead. The person that you're trying to talk to is dead. Satan, I don't know who you're talking to, because the person that you're trying to contact is dead. They're not alive anymore. Amen. I am dead to sin. I am not a part of it. He has no sway over me. He has no right to contact me. I am not going to give in. I'm not going back. I'm not going to do what I used to do. I'm not going to be with who I used to be with. Amen. I'm not going back to that life, because that me is dead. Amen. He's talking to the wrong person. So when Satan tries to put stuff in my head, I say, who are you talking to? Oh, you ain't talking to me, are you? I'm not who you think I am. Amen? I am a new creature, a new creation. I have been made new in him. I am not who I used to be. I'm dead to this world. I may be walking through it, but I am not alive. I proclaim that I am dead. Amen. They told us to quit doing that on the radio, brother. You know, they said, we're not, you know, being in law enforcement, Although somebody may be good and dead, I can't say that they're dead. Because if I do, that becomes official. And officially, I'm not a doctor. Amen? Somebody has to have clearance to do such a thing. And so we used to sometimes get on the radio and say, this pastor, well, we'll say 10-7. That means you're out of service. And you say this, but because sometimes you don't want people to drive 100 miles an hour to get somewhere where somebody's passed on. They might get killed on the way, so dispatcher 10-7. Now we just tell dispatch, tell them to step it down. You know, there's no don't run emergency traffic, step it down. I can't say that. But I can officially say this. I want to proclaim you dead tonight. Amen. I want to proclaim me dead and you dead. In fact, I don't want the devil to have any foothold in our lives. It's time we quit listening to that. And I know it's hard. When you've been deployed for a long time, it becomes hard sometimes to not take on some of the culture around you. Kids, when you're in school, it's hard. Being around a lot of people who don't know Jesus and people who do know Jesus but pretend they don't when they're in school. You know, it's tough. It's tough. People at work, I know what it's like. It's hard sometimes when you're surrounded by that. But you have to remember where your citizenship is. You've got to remember who you belong to. I'm a child of the King.
Amen.
Amen. I am not alive in this world. I'm dead. I'm a child of the King. And I'm alive in Christ. And for me to really be alive in Christ and experience the fullness of that, then I've got to be dead to the world. Amen. I can't live in both. I can't serve two masters. And so if I can let go and be dead, then I can be alive. I know that makes a lot of sense, doesn't it? Death has no power over us anymore. Sin has no power. The curse of sin has no power off someone who's forgiven. Amen. So the weight of my failures, the weight of my failures as a human being, as a father, as a son, as a person, the weight of my failures doesn't stick with me. It's gone. I'm forgiven. Amen. I'm dead to that. That was the old me. The old me is dead. It's under the blood of Jesus. I'm forgiven. How good does it feel to get rid of the weight of your failures? Amen. The devil will bring them back to you again and again. I don't care if they're under the blood or not. Lord may have forgotten, but Jesus, he forgave them, but the devil, he remembers. And he brings them back. And he says, look at what you are, what you've done, where you're going. I'm telling you, quit listening to him. Say, I'm dead. I'm dead. You got the wrong address, Satan. I know you came looking for me, but that means dead. He's not here no more. Amen. You've got the wrong house. Send that mail on. Return to sender. Not here. Amen. Don't negotiate with the devil. You'll lose every time. Amen. You're not going to out-negotiate him. Some people thought they knew me, but they knew the old me. Amen. I run into people that knew the old me, and they think they know me. And then after a while, they say, you're not. You're different. So thank you. Amen. Thank you. No, I'm not who I used to be. I'm not that person anymore. That me is dead. Amen. Our goal in this life is to be the walking dead. We're passing through, but we're not alive to this world. I'm not a citizen of it. I don't go by the rules of it. I listen to him. I'm a child of the King. We are sons and daughters of God. Amen. I don't adhere to the world. I adhere to him.
Amen.
Amen. So I'm closing. Tonight I want to be able to say this, and you be able to say it too, that I'm no longer a part of guilt and shame. I'm no longer a part of guilt and shame. I'm no longer a part of addiction. I'm no longer a part of bondage. I'm no longer a part of it. That means it's dead. Amen? Christ paid the price, church. He paid it. He took it on himself. That means dead. I'm not a part of that anymore. And I know a lot of times we say, oh, Lord, I'm forgiven, but we still carry bondage and addiction and shame. Don't carry that. Be dead. Be proclaimed dead tonight. I am dead to the world. I'm dead to those things. And I am free. I'm free. Amen. It feels good to be free. I am free. When you're really dead, you're free. Amen. I don't belong anymore. It's kind of like this. I've turned my notice in. I'm just working my time out. Amen. I done turned my paperwork in. I'm a free man. You want to send me on? Send me on. Amen. I'm ready to move on anyways. Amen. I don't have any obligation to what's going on anymore because I turned my notice in. Amen. I turned my notice in a while ago. So that means that I'm not a part of this world. I don't have to worry about it. I don't have to deal with it. All I have to do, I've got a new boss. I've got a new boss that I work for, and as long as I keep him happy, I don't care what anybody else thinks. Amen. Run me down all you want to. I'm dead. I'm dead to them. You ever heard somebody say that? Well, they're dead to me. Well, that's not a bad thing. I want to be dead to Satan. I want to be dead to this world. And I do not care what anybody else says. They can call me a holy roller. They can run me down. They can say anything they want to say. Because as long as I please my Heavenly Father, He is the one who has set me free. Hallelujah. I'm proud to be dead. Proclaimed dead. I am certified. I am dead to this world, but I am alive in Christ. And I am more alive than I have ever been. He said He came so that we may have life and that more abundantly. Well, I want it. Amen. I want to be dead to the world and alive in Him. I want to feel freedom in Him. To pass through the world but not have to worry about it. So sickness, burdens, I don't care what it is. I'm not connected to it. I know somebody that will deal with it for me. Amen. I cast my cares upon Him. He takes care of all that for me. Because I don't work here anymore. Amen. I turned my notice in. In church, tonight, I ask you, have you been proclaimed dead? Have you turned your notice in? The first thing is this. You know, death comes for us all. And I know some people that they're pretty sure about their salvation in their way of life until they get to that point. When they get that terminal diagnosis, when it doesn't look like that they're going to make it, then you really get serious. Why wait until then? Amen. Don't wait until you're on your deathbed before you decide to actually consider. I don't care if you sit in a pew all your life. It doesn't matter. Amen. Do you know? If death comes knocking, if the Lord were to require your soul tonight, are you satisfied with where you're at? Because if you're not, you have an opportunity. And we're going to start with that. Heavenly Father, Lord, in this place, Lord, all across, Lord, we're in the midst of some good folk right here. But Lord, I know that when it comes down to it, we like to avoid death and we don't think about it. But Lord, I know that it's coming. Lord, if you tarry, we're all going to taste of it. Lord, are we ready? Lord, if there be anyone in here this evening that would say that they're not 100% sure, if they're ready to go right now, if you were to call us home this evening, Lord, I pray that they can get that worked out here tonight. Lord, they don't need to go back and worry about it. Lord, they can get peace in their soul right here and right now. Heavenly Father, let them have that. And Lord, I pray you work through the rest of us as well. Church, this altar is open. If you need